Not so long ago, I shared with you a comparison between the Moonshine, the Moonlight Sonata of Beethoven, the last movement played by me and by Valentina Lisitsa, and we made some comparisons because of the fact that in the notation there might be something that we were missing. Obviously, her performance was much more impressive from a technical perspective than mine. And it will surprise you perhaps that already in 1863 performances of a similar speed to that of Valentina Lisitsa were already documented. But the price we have to pay for that source is high. We'll have to accept also that that tempo was considered to be double the tempo of that what Beethoven originally had in mind. And indeed, that my tempo was quote-unquote correct. If you want to know more about this, stay tuned, because this video is just about that. So welcome everybody here on Authentic Sound. This channel is all about trying to reconstruct that original, that authentic thought of the composer, those 5 seconds before Beethoven started to note down his 5th symphony. What was he thinking? What was he hearing in his head? And in order to reconstruct that, we will have to look at many aspects from a different perspective, hence that we want to unchain you, perhaps a little bit from today's mainstream practice where we have settled in a certain performance practice. And today I want to look back to the comparison video I made between my version of the Presto Agitato of the Moonlight Sonata and Valentina Lisitsa's. As a disclaimer always, when I bring musicians to this channel for reasons of comparison, whatever, I'm not criticizing their work. We are all responsible for the way we interpret those works, and we have the right to do it in the way we want to do it. So if I bring people like Valentina Lisitsa onto this channel, it's not because I don't respect their work. But what I would like to do today is just reverse things a little bit and go back in history and see what happens if we bring on stage Adolf Bernhard Marx. I have here the original print in German, is Anleitung zum Vortrag Beethovenschen Klavierwerke, so the introduction to Beethoven keyboard works. This is easy to find on the internet, so go ahead and read it because it's interesting stuff. Adolf Bernhard Marx was a contemporary of Czerny Moscheles. He was chief editor of the Berliner Musikalische Zeitung, so the kind of Berlin musical gazette, if you want. And even Beethoven liked to read his pieces because they were in Berlin considered to be a little bit provocative, and apparently Beethoven liked that. But he writes on tempo in a time that is long after Beethoven's death, and I think in a time that has changed that music and the perspective on that music in so drastically on a general scale. Marx is exactly writing on that. I'm going to give you one quote, and that will clarify a lot why I started this video the way I did. So I'm quoting from this book, and I will give you that quote on screen, but I will read some excerpts that are really interesting. He talks about the Allegro of the Opus 101, in which he says that for an accomplished player, it is not impossible to play this passage as fast again as is meet. And then he says, but can the listener be able to perceive and feel all the voices which form the polyphonic network, and so on. And later he goes on saying a similar thing on the Opus 27, number 2, among other works. So he says, if you really, we must ask them, the players who play those works way too fast, if you really, we must ask them, play the finales of the sonatas Opus 26, 27, number 2, 53, and 57, twice as fast as they ought to be played, do the sentences really become more brilliant? So the interesting thing of this quote, the intriguing part of this quote, is if we reverse the things, and you see there my version of the Presto Agitato with Lisitsa's, and by the way, that is not different, her version, than from, she's maybe on the fast side compared to all the other versions, but all the other versions of the mainstream performance practice, in which I think also the people who play on fortepianos, on periodical instruments, they don't differ that much from mainstream performance practices for people who play on modern instruments. So if you have all these pianists, then the intriguing thing is that for someone like Marx, who was a contemporary of Czerny, Moscheles, in the midst of musical life in what we would call today Germany, was actually admired a little bit by Beethoven, who liked to, as I said, to read his pieces. If those pianists want to be labeled as accomplished pianists, which by the way they are, but by Marx, there is no other option for them than to accept my tempo, the Czerny Holbeat tempo of the Presto Agitato, as the authentic one. Because they will never be able to double their tempi, which they now consider to be the authentic Beethoven one. So this is a strong source, this is a strong quote, this is a quote that you'll have to reject completely, entirely, because if you don't, it has the power of correcting a lot of accepted performance practices today, where also people from the early music movement, I have to say that, are actually advocating for these past performances as being authentic to Beethoven. And worse, they actually go further and say, we have to increase the speed because the authentic, the original, the periodical pianos, they allow the faster speeds, which is of course, I think you can label that really as nonsense. The aftertouch was not invented to make pianos slower, but that's a whole other discussion. This ratio 1 to 2 is regardless of any metronome numbers, regardless of any tempo indication, you will have to be able to match that. And there is no way you can double the tempo Lisitsa has. There is no way you can double the tempo Pollini chose for this piece. As there is no way you can double the tempo of almost any other pianist today. And so, I thought this was worth sharing with you, because quotes like this, if you read them from our today's perspective of mainstream performance practice, you will have, they might just escape your attention as, yeah, what's this guy talking about? But if you go over these sources, sources like this, and you have a lot of these guys, it's the original sources, go back and read them, just few pages, but they open your mind and try to have a perspective here. What would happen? How would I understand this particular quote if I accepted WBMP as an historical truth? What would happen if I accept the single beat reading as an historical quote? And for quotes like this, there is only one solution, as for many quotes. I see this reconstruction. This reconstruction, or these attempts that we have for reconstructing that music, because don't ever think that we come that close again as to say for 100%, with 100% certainty, that was the way Beethoven played, that was the way Chopin played. We will never be able to do that. Every day we live is a day further from Beethoven, further from Chopin, further from Liszt. Well, we can try, and there is a lot of things that we can take more seriously than that. We can apply a certain perspective. We can have as an overlay a certain perspective on those authentic original sources and then see what fits. And as I said, this is for me like a puzzle that at the end should give you a kind of nice image. And every piece of that puzzle, as this is one, should fit that image. And if you paste it on that huge image with a lot of empty spots and you say this doesn't make sense, it doesn't fit, then your interpretation is wrong. Then you have to go over it again and find something else. And in the case of tempo reconstruction for this time, that's the exciting thing. We only have two options. The metronome numbers, if we consider them to be accurate tempo indications, and if we don't have a common ground to have any conversation, because then of course then we are in the empty air. But if we accept the fact, which makes sense, I think, and is backed by a lot of historical quotes, that metronome numbers given in that time were just accurate tempo indications, and I mean, what else would they be? Then we have two solutions. We either apply the WBMP, where the ticks of the metronome indicate the subdivision of the note value, very much like in the pendulum time and the Mendel time, where the tactus marked the subdivision of the semibrevis, when the conductors still today perform Renaissance music, their arms go up and down and mark the minims, so the half notes, not the semibrevis. But yet in those days, the tactus was one beat, one schlag, and one schlag equaled the semibrevis. So it's exactly that practice. It's not so hard to understand that this transition is like very natural. Or you apply the single beat interpretation, and if that works, then these quotes become problematic, as is the playing. So guys, this is an interesting source. I'm not saying you, I'm not telling you, go to Adalbert Marx to find all the correct early 19th century authentic performance indications. But these sources, they contain valuable information. You have to position them into the context of their time. You have to know what they're talking about. You have to know what their position was, what their perspective was. You cannot just have one-on-one these sources applied to the performance practice if you want to go back to Beethoven's time. But you will find a lot of valuable information that on this large board, this large image, you'll have to find a spot. You'll have to find a kind of perspective that fits. That's so exciting also because we can apply that to music. We can sit behind the keys of our pianos. It's without cost. It costs just a little bit of time. And we get a new world. We get a new perspective. And what's cooler than that? We don't have to build a house, we don't have to build a painting, we just have to press the keys with our fingers and the result is immediately there. Not saying that it's easy to play on WBMP, and those videos will come to introduce you also to some key elements that you'll need to understand in order to make it work. Because with changing tempo, we change everything, certainly those aspects of performance practice. So guys, thanks for watching. Don't forget to subscribe and to hit the bell if you want to stay on top of everything we do. And also make us continue on full speed. And in order to do that, we need you. Become a member of our Patreon site. There's a link here and also in the description box. And there you'll find a beautiful community and a lot of other things that you just might enjoy as much as watching these videos, I hope. So, thanks for watching and see you soon again.